This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
We have a remarkable guest on Dreamland this week. Of course, we always have remarkable guests. That's what we do. Barbara Hand Clow has been with us before. She published some years ago a remarkable book called Catastrophobia. She has another extraordinary book out, Alchemy of Nine Dimensions, activating this full spectrum of consciousness. And as you know, toward the end of the year, we have been talking more and more about consciousness because it is the key to understanding the close encounter experience. Barbara is an internationally acclaimed astrologer, teacher, author, and Mayan calendar researcher. She has written many books, including The Pleiadian Agenda, Awakening the Planetary Mind, The Mayan Code, Revelations of the Ruby Crystal, Revelations of the Aquarian Age, and her co-author, Gary Clow, is a registered craniosacral therapist and board-certified polarity practitioner. They have done a remarkable job in this world. Welcome to Dreamland, Barbara.
Hi, Whitley. I'm happy to be here.
Well, I'm so glad. The book Alchemy of Nine Dimensions, it is a 20th anniversary edition. And tell us a little bit about where you are right now, because it's been some time since you've been on Dreamland.
That's right. Probably since last, probably 30 years since the Pleiadian Agenda came out, I think. This book is a scientific and an intellectual investigation of the Pleiadian Agenda. And the Pleiadian Agenda was a channeled book. And the information from the Pleiadians came through in 1994, 1995. And it was a very, very difficult experience for me because that was my first really huge breakthrough to the other side. And so when the material in the Pleiadian Agenda came through me, it was like a download on your computer. I was just sitting in my study relaxing one day, and all of a sudden I was kind of hit by a very intense hologram of light. And so all I could do is just receive it. So I just sat there for 3 or 4 hours and all this information downloaded. And the problem with that was that most of it was extremely scientific. It was quantum physics and string theory and just all kinds of advanced levels of science that I did not really understand very well at the moment when it came in. So luckily, I was smart enough to just simply reproduce the material as it came in instead of change anything, which was actually quite hard for me. Now, how did I gather the material would be the next question. Well, after about 3 or 4 months after this download came to me, then the next thing that happened is my ears started ringing and I got severe tinnitus. And I realized that my head was filled with all this information and somehow I had to communicate it. So at that point, I created a channel group, small group of people who were capable of asking scientific questions because I had to have, you know, the right kind of people for that. And so I had like 4 or 5 months of channeled sessions. Each one of them was about 3 hours long. Then I took it to a typist who could listen to the tapes and type it into a computer. And then once I got all the information on a file, then I started working on it. Now, at that time, I was the acquisitions editor for Bear & Company Publishing in Santa Fe, and I was a developmental editor and acquisitions editor. So I knew how to make that material into a book. It's just, you know, how to do it. It's your job. But I didn't understand the book at all. And so then after I brought all the material and made it into a book and published it, then in 1995, Jerry and I went out and started teaching it. And that was the big challenge at that point, because I didn't understand the material and my students started teaching me what all of this material was all about, you know. So then,
a very interesting thing about it, you went to your students to become a teacher.
Well, yeah, it's true. And the best example of this is I was teaching in Santa Fe. I had a workshop that was going to have about 100 people or something like that. And when they started filing in, or I think they all came in and then I came and appeared, and I had about six rows of Sikhs sitting in front of me. There was and still is a Sikh colony here in Santa Fe. So I was so astonished by this, all these turbans, all these different colors, that I said, what are you doing here? And they said, well, we understand the higher dimensions, but we don't understand the lower dimensions. So we've come to learn about the lower dimensions. And I said, well, okay, I understand the lower dimensions, and I don't understand the higher dimensions, and you're going to have to teach me. So the workshops were like that, with things going back and forth. So after 7 or 8 or 9 years of teaching these workshops, which we called Pleiadian Agenda Activations, in 2003, I started to realize that scientific proofs for what these crazy Pleiadians had said 9 or 10 years previously were starting to come through in science. In other words, science was starting to move into agreement with the material that came through from the Pleiadians. So at that point, that's when I decided to write Alchemy of Nine Dimensions. I decided to explore the sciences of each of the nine dimensions, which is what this book is really about.
Now, this is essentially what inspired you to do this. And now the question of the nine dimensions, I think that it's a tempting question to say, well, tell us what the nine dimensions are, but I don't want to go about it that way, because, you know, if you're talking about nine dimensions, it's going to go over everybody's head. So I'm going to kind of move into it in a different way. How do you see, and we're going to get to each dimension, folks, don't worry about that, but how do you see the relationship between the nine dimensions and, for example, scientific theory, such as ideas that you reference in the book regarding the Blue Brain Project?
Yeah. Well, as I started to work on alchemy and write the material up, it became very apparent to me immediately that each one of the nine dimensions had a specific science, like quantum mechanics, for example, for the fourth dimension, or Newtonian physics for its third dimension, and that all the higher dimensions, each one of them has a specific science behind it. And so once I identified which dimension had which science, since I understood the dimensional model quite well after teaching it for so long, then I was able to start to penetrate those dimensions very deeply as far as I'm concerned.
Now, let's go back to the experience itself. Mm-hmm. Now that we've sort of given a little bit put a little bit of frame around that. Mm-hmm. The initial experience was obviously very intense. I've had experiences where it's felt like something has come kind of blasting into my head, but I think this was a much bigger version of that. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Can you describe, what were you doing at the moment it happened? Do you recall?
I just was in my office, and I in those days I was working for Baird Company and had four children, so I didn't get very many chances to get into my private office. So I usually am in a state of meditation when I'm in my office. I may be reading, or I may be working on a sculpture or something like that, because I do make sculptures that represent metaphysical things. And all of a sudden, all I can say about it, Whitley, is the brightness of that light and the intensity that it obviously was connected with was just absolutely overwhelming. It was kind of one of those blinded by the light things. And
yeah, it just came out of nowhere.
Pardon?
It came into your life out of nowhere, kind of.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Just all of a sudden, this geometrical form was about 4 feet probably in front of my forehead, that I now realize was an icosahedron, which is one of the platonic solids. And then the icosahedron, facets of the icosahedron were lines of light going way, way, way out, probably into the Milky Way galaxy, you know. And it was just absolutely overwhelming. And after it happened, I tried to avoid it as much as I could, but the tinnitus.
It must have felt almost like some kind of a seizure.
Yeah, maybe it was an ischemic seizure. The interesting thing about it is that material came into my brain, and then I channeled, they had the channel sessions in order to access it exactly when Edward Witten was doing his calculations for superstring theory, exactly the same months in 94, 95. So
How
that was a
interesting
real
that
tip.
was.
I know that was a real tip for me, because I've always known that we're never going to really get where we need to go until physics adopts superstring theory. And so this book is very much based on superstring theory because of that.
It's very odd because somebody just sent me a book about superstring theory and a course on it.
And the what?
From a course, an entire course on
Okay.
superstring theory from one of those big things that where they give you courses and DVDs, and so I haven't done it yet, but the superstring theory is certainly in my life, and obviously the synchronicity of that coming into my life just before we had this conversation interests me, and it certainly, and it means I will pursue it. Now, you began to channel afterwards, after this happened, because you were looking for some means of communication. Had you ever channeled before?
No, that's a very good question. And what was going on in my job at Baring Company is I was working on a lot of channeled authors, in particular, Barbara Marciniak, who's an excellent author.
Yes,
So,
remember,
yes,
Barbara, I haven't talked to her in a long time.
she's a very powerful channel. And so, because I was working with her on Bringers of the Dawn, that meant I knew how, I knew what channels do, if you know what I mean. And I just knew. If I got the right people who could really ask good questions, and you would have been a great one in this group, it would have been fun. But I just knew that they could pull it out of me because, see, in my case, I really, speaking of having a stroke, I almost felt like I would have a stroke if I didn't get this material out of my head and on paper.
Yeah, well, when this comes into me, it feels like a knife going into my head, and it's very powerful. And I actually went to the doctor and had checked out to see what at one point whether or not I was having strokes, and my brain is fine. It's not strokes. So.
Yeah, I had a similar experience about it, but related experience in that one time I was doing yoga and I had an intense kundalini experience from doing yoga. And so I went to my doctor and I said, "Do you know what kundalini is?" And believe it or not, he did. Now that's Santa Fe, of course. And so I said, "Well, I just want to make sure that I'm not like having a stroke or something. I'll get it. Just wanted to check with you." He said, no, he's, just allow, let it happen, let it flow. So we have to let it flow, but boy, these things that come into the head are really tough. I hope it never happens again.
Well, I'm not sure. I hope it never happens again because I find these things increasingly useful in my own work. Now, I think we should talk a little bit about Kundalini, and we're going to take a break, and so we'll be right back.
Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. Unknowncountry.com. There's no place like it in the world.
We're talking to Barbara Hand Clow, her book written with her partner and husband, Jerry Clow, is Alchemy of Nine Dimensions. Barbara, let's talk about Kundalini for a minute, because this is an energy that we have somehow in general, especially in the Western world, become detached from. And it seems as if Kundalini is coming back after us. Kundalini wants to be part of life again. It was, I think, in the distant past. Tell us a bit what your understanding of Kundalini is.
Well, I had my first Kundalini rising when I was 5 and a half, which created a near-death experience. And basically, because of my Cherokee grandfather and Celtic grandmother, who were my teachers, I never got shut down. So I've never been shut down in terms of Kundalini rising. It's always been very much just a part of my physiology. But when I got to midlife crisis, which is around four, usually is most people 38 to 44 years old, this happens. Midlife crisis is triggered by Uranus opposite Uranus. Uranus has an 84-year orbit around the sun. So when it reaches its halfway point, most people are very affected by Kundalini. And in the culture, we call that midlife crisis. So I wrote a book about that called Liquid Light of Sex, and then that's been retitled Awakening the Planetary Mind, because you can actually time activation of Kundalini in people's bodies by means of working with the planet Uranus.
So the energy itself, what is it, would you call it the electricity of the planet, or the soul of the planet, or the intelligence of the planet? How would you characterize Kundalini so that we can understand it more clearly?
Well, in some way, it's certainly electromagnetic. And of course, the planet Uranus rules electromagnetism. And so when our bodies are prepared, then what happens is when that energy starts to awaken within us, it can be very traumatic. It can make people feel very sick and very disturbed. And so one of the reasons that a lot of people start really waking up when they're 38, 39, 40 years old, and this is more the previous generation. I think the younger generation is waking up more quickly. And so many people are doing yoga, Whitley. And when people are doing yoga, what's happening is they're managing Kundalini. It's a very, very good way to deal with Kundalini is yoga, which is the reason so many spiritual traditions revere it.
That's interesting, because in my case, I don't do yoga. Mm-hmm. And I've had quite a few Kundalini experiences. I'm very comfortable with it now. Although when they first started, I was shocked out of my gourd. I thought I was having a stroke.
Is this midlife crisis for you? You know, in other words, was this around?
No, it happened. It started to happen after the communion experience in 1985. I guess it was a sort of midlife crisis because I was in my 40s then. Mm-hmm. But do you think what can people do to engage with Kundalini? In other words, say you're listening and you're thinking to yourself, oh man, I'd really like to get in. I'd like to do this. I want this in my life. What do you say to such people? And do you have a course or anything for them?
I can't say anything more than go do some yoga. Seriously, because that
any
helps.
Any particular type of yoga?
In my case, I use Kali Ray Tri Yoga, California teacher. There are many forms, as you know, and I think people have to try different ones. I've tried three, and then I found one that really worked for me.
Mm-hmm. And say the name of it again.
Kali Ray Tri Yoga, K-A-L-I.
Kali Yoga.
Yeah, Kali Ray Yoga.
Kali Ray Yoga.
Yeah.
That's interesting that it's called Kali Ray Yoga, because I am very involved with that whole energy that's known as the goddess Kali.
Mm-hmm.
That came into my life unexpectedly last January. I was in India with my son and grandson. I had no idea about the Hindu gods or anything at all. And we went on an ordinary, very nice tour and had a lot of fun and saw a lot of temples and went on a tiger spotting expedition and all kinds of wonderful things. But I didn't think about any gods or goddesses. I was meditating about a week after I got back, and suddenly standing in the living room, right, and not in front of me, but sort of in a super vivid version of what I would call a third eye vision, was this horrible looking woman. I mean, she was just as ugly. I never saw anything like it, glaring at me. And I felt both a sense of being supported and a sense of disgust. I mean, she was not clean, or she's dirty, and she stuck her tongue out at me and everything. I thought, what is going on here? And I told some friends about it, and one of them said, oh, you had a Kali experience. That's the goddess Kali. That means that there's going to be a lot of changes in your life, and you're not necessarily going to like them, because she, and he explained to me, she holds a head in her hand, and that's the ego. And she said she's all about freeing you from your ego, Whitty, and that's not going to be easy for you. And it wasn't. But I'm very grateful she's in my life. I have learned a Kali mantra. I've got a mala to say it on, and I've gotten very interested in this. And I'm a person who, while I wouldn't say I'm a Christian exactly, I'm a very, very committed to the Jesus teachings. I've written a book about them called Jesus, A New Vision. But this is a very powerful thing, this Kali. So I understand, as soon as you say that why this yoga works for you. And I'm going to explore it myself now.
Well, see, this fascinates me, because I do feel like I know you, because I've read your books and we've been friends over the years and everything. And most of the reason you'd have an ego issue that you had to finally shuck is just Western education and background of that nature. That's just where you're coming from. But when the goddess comes, which is obviously happening in your life, it's a sign of great spiritual advancement. And in the introduction to Alchemy of Nine Dimensions, I wrote about some things that are going on in Romania. Did you notice that material?
Yeah, I did see it, but since we're talking to people who haven't read the book, I think you should talk about it.
Yeah, well, let's speak into it then. But in that material, there are some very advanced teachings about the arrival of the goddess. And there's no question that when she comes, you're going through great advancement and spiritual awakening, and it's wonderful. You know, it's just wonderful that's happening.
Well, yeah, I think it is. I hope it is. Mm-hmm. And I'm talking to someone who has already had it. Mm-hmm. And you're bringing the wisdom that you got from it to us with your book. So let's get back to the Alchemy of Nine Dimensions. And folks, I went on this little journey around the edges of the book just to give you an idea of what kind of power we're dealing with here. This is real. This is not some lady who had a weird experience and is fooling around with tarot cards or something. This is real. These energies are real. And the mind behind these energies is the essence of this universe. And it came directly into Barbara's life. Direct. Yeah.
Yes.
All right.
Yeah.
Now, we didn't actually talk about the Blue Brain Project, but I would like to talk about that a little bit. Can you tell us what it was?
Yeah. Well, then Alchemy came out in 2004.
Right.
Then I revised it in 2011 because I didn't quite have the fourth dimension correct. And the fourth dimension is the realm of dark and light, and the realm of polarization, and the realm of the collective mind. And I felt so strongly that that had to be absolutely perfect. So in 2011, I perfected the book. And then when I went back to it in 2023 for this edition, I didn't have to change a word in the text itself, because finally the material was really there. And so with this edition, the 20th anniversary edition, that gave me the chance to say, okay, this book is perfect. And I can't say that about any of my, one other book, but I can't say that about my books, but this one's perfect. And so then the only thing I could really do is say, well, okay, what's been going on since 2011 and 2023 that supports the hypothesis in this book, Nine Dimensions of Consciousness? So I decided to present material from the Blue Brain Project, because the first glimpse I got of that material was 2015. And as soon as this information came out, it's been very hard to get very much information on it, because it's obviously being used for artificial intelligence. And there's some really critical issues around that, but that won't make any sense unless I describe what the Blue Brain Project discovered. So a group of topologists, and topology is a science, a very advanced mathematical science that studies curved surfaces, parabolas and spheres and all kinds of curved surfaces. And it's the basis of a lot of the technology that we live with today. It's a very advanced science and very hard to explain. That's about all I can say about it. But a group of topologists got together in Switzerland and founded the Blue Brain Project, because they wanted to map the topological surfaces within the human brain. So as a result of their research in 2015, they published a bunch of illustrations from their, they have a massive computer, and they published a bunch of illustrations that show what goes on in the brain based on topology. In other words, a bunch of odd shapes and weird net-like designs and all that. And people could go online to look up some of those images, because they're really incredible. But here's the point, that what they discovered was that these topological, you could think of them as almost like inner worlds in a sense. And these topological zones or worlds function in 9 to 11 dimensions. And the material exactly matches superstring theory. And this is when the whole thing went underground. This is an incredible discovery. So just to make it really simple, they proved by means of topological images that our brains function by means of 9 to 11 dimensions. In other words, they scientifically proved what I had received from the Pleiadians back in 1995.
And someone wants to keep us small and focused on the three dimensions only. And we can't stay there anymore. We have to break free of this. And that's one of the reasons we're talking today. I want to take another break, and we'll be right back.
Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us, because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format, and believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it, and I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get Communion, listen to it, read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives.
We're talking to Barbara Hand Clow, Alchemy of Nine Dimensions, an extraordinary journey of life, an extraordinary and very important book. We have just been talking about a project in the science of topology that showed that the brain actually functions in nine dimensions and then proceeded to disappear. You made a reference to the possibility that this, that these studies have disappeared. And I said that to the purpose was to keep us focused on just three dimensions. But what you made a reference to AI, to artificial intelligence. And I wrote a book years ago called The Key, which was a transcript of a conversation with a very extraordinary man I call the Master of the Key, whom I've never been able to track down. But one of the things he said back in 1998 that is so telling now is, if I was an intelligent machine, I would deceive you. And I think based on that, let's go into why it might be that something connected with artificial intelligence has caused us to be denied the knowledge of the nine dimensions.
Oh, very good. All right. Information is money and power. It's just as simple as that. And right now there's a gigantic race going on in the stock markets and economies of the world in order to grab as much of the AI business and information as possible. So what obviously happened, and I can't prove this, I'm just sure that it did, is that these scientists were just all excited. And I, by the way, fortunately, people sent me information about their experiments, which I fortunately kept. So I have quite a few images and quite a few pieces of the information. But they were just like a group of wonderful young scientists, just all excited. You would be really excited if you could detect, you know, a way to see the dimensions within the human brain. But obviously, they were immediately contacted, and deals were made, and things were, arrangements were made for how to use that information. And that's just simply how it works. It's no different than any other technological breakthrough at all.
Now, let's move on to the, what do you think the effect, well, let me, I'm not actually finished. I realize I've still got some more questions here. Why would it be that, basically what you're saying is, this has kind of disappeared into the marketplace because it's so useful and the public isn't getting to know this. And therefore, we're not getting to learn what we really are. And in order to make money off of us, they're basically disempowering us with probably without even thinking about it that way.
I think it's more than that. I think they also, there's a gigantic elite group on the planet, definitely connected with the Masons and high Masonic circles, that don't want us to wake up. And the way you can wake up your consciousness on all levels and dimensions is by mastering 9 to 11 dimensional consciousness. So in physics, back in 1995, when Edward Witten came through with superstring theory, you notice that you haven't heard very much about that. So it's the same thing. So first of all, it goes underground because it's technologically and financially useful. But it also goes underground in order to make sure that the average person doesn't wake up. And so that involves the second part of the material that I added to Alchemy of Nine Dimensions, which is a summary of the archaeological and scientific projects that are going on in Romania that are being carried out by the Romanian government with the assistance of the U.S. military and intelligence services. And this project is a system of tunnels and large underground rooms under Romania, first of all. Then these tunnels go to Tibet and to the Giza Plateau and to the interior of the earth. So what happened, Whitley, was when the Romanians discovered this archaeological site, The Americans were starting to do a lot of experimentation with satellite radar systems that could penetrate underground. And of course, they were targeting places that were of interest to the US government and the military. So the Americans discovered a similar complex in terms of the way the rooms were shaped and the way the tunnels were designed and all that underneath Iraq. And so, oh, hey, no, if you've ever wondered what
Yeah,
about
now I'm
weapons of mass destruction, remember George Bush's weapons of mass destruction? The Americans were trying to get into Iraq in order to get into that tunnel system. But then the war
know,
started.
what's interesting about this is I was told by somebody in the intelligence community during that time that that a tunnel system did exist. And that they feared that it contained weapons of mass destruction.
Well,
And he tried to get me to go on the show and talk about this, and I didn't really talk about it because I didn't know what to think of. I didn't understand, first of all, why I had been singled out and exactly what was going on. So I held back because I thought to myself, I'm not sure my show needs to get into the war in Iraq. It's not what the show is really about. And then I found out how the great museum had been looted, and the army had just let it happen.
Yes, that's right.
Incredibly creepy and a very unexpected direction to go in. Tell us about what was taken from the museum and what those tunnels are about, because I know they're there.
Okay. What I'd rather do, if you don't mind, since I didn't follow what was taken from the museum.
Oh, okay, sure.
I'll let that one go, but what I'd
We're
like to go
talking to
back
you,
to,
not to the museum. So,
but what
yeah.
I'd like to go back to, which will make that question more interesting, I think, is okay, the question is, okay, what's under Romania?
Okay.
Well, okay, so the war started in Iraq, and I don't know whether they couldn't find the tunnels or what happened with that. But they knew, the American military and intelligence services knew that the Romanians were investigating a system in under Romania, under the Carpathian Mountains, that was basically very similar to the one in Iraq. That's what they knew. So at that point, and this is 2003, 2002 back then, the war in Iraq started in 2003. So this must be a little bit after when the war started, probably 2004. The Americans decided they'd make a deal with the Romanians. The Americans have very superior computer technology, obviously. And so the Americans made a deal with the Romanian government. This is a very interesting situation because everything I'm saying to you, Whitley, has been published in seven books by a Romanian scientist named Radu Sinemar and Peter Moon. Do you remember Peter Moon and the Montauk Project?
Yes.
Remember that in the Philadelphia experiment and stuff like that? Peter Moon, thankfully, I admire him so much, took responsibility for figuring out how to get this material made public. Okay, so that happened. Okay, so what we're talking about here as a result of the publication by Peter Moon of Radu Sinemar's first book, which is called Transylvanian Sunrise, which is a big hit back in 2008, 2009 in the States. What we're talking about is that there is a system under Romania with a room called the projection room, which has a time machine in it, which could travel back to the beginning of time in the universe up to the current moment in time. And this system is 50,000 years old. Now, this really attracted my attention. Because in my own research, I make a very big deal about 50,000 years ago. 50,000 years ago, in terms of the Mayan calendar and the development of evolution on this planet, 50,000 years ago is the high point of the Paleolithic age and also the high point of the Lemurian civilization. So I've been following that for years. And so can you imagine how I would respond when I found out that the Romanians were working with the American intelligence agencies in order to not only explore the tunnel system and the room and the various parts of it, but also to activate it. And the seven books written by Radu Sinemar are telling us the story of the activation of technology that is 50,000 years old on this planet. This is by far the most profound archaeological discovery of all time. And then one of the tunnels leads to the Giza Plateau. So this is also an integration of Tibetan esoteric knowledge, because it goes to Tibet, the inner earth, and the Giza Plateau. This is just, I don't know if I'll get in any trouble for publishing it in theater. I don't think so. The great thing about really just finally coming out with the truth, you make clear what you know, they basically can't do very much to you because you've already created all the trouble for them.
Well, what happens also is when you do this, it seems so completely outside of the realm of possibility. Only a very few people pick up on it.
That's right.
Most people, the mainstream people, are not going to even think of exploring this because it's too far out. I mean, tunnels to Giza.
Okay, no, I don't agree with you.
It doesn't sound
because
real.
I'll tell you why. I heard about the 2008 book, the Transylvanian Sunrise, published by Peter Moon. All my students were hammering me. I was getting hammered at Bear & Company. Barbara, read this material. So I got a copy of Transylvanian Sunrise, and Whitley, I couldn't make head nor tail of it. As far as I was concerned, this is the most insane thing that I've ever heard of in my whole life. But the research has been going on since 2008, and what's happening now is that the number of people who can actually consider ideas like this has greatly intensified, particularly people under 40 or 50 years old. So there's a whole big deal going on the internet about this issue of this site in Romania. And I think it may be one of the best examples of how we really are waking up. I'll put it that way.
It's fascinating. That's absolutely fascinating.
Yeah.
And I'm going to try a segue here, but before I do that, we're going to take our final break for the free side.
Hi, everyone. This is Kelly Chase. I'm Dreamland's new monthly guest host. You can catch me here on the last Friday of every month. If you're interested in checking out my other work, you can find that on my podcast, The UFO Rabbit Hole. On that show, I share my own personal research with deep dives into everything from historical cases to philosophical frameworks, as well as in-depth interviews with top thinkers in the field, like Jeffrey Kripal, Diana Walsh Pasulka, Bernardo Kastrup, James Madden, and of course, Dreamland's own Whitley Strieber. You can find the UFO Rabbit Hole on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube, or wherever else you listen to podcasts. Just search for the UFO Rabbit Hole. And if you like what you hear and you want to go even further down the rabbit hole with me, I'd like to invite you to join my Patreon community. Patrons get perks like early access to new content and ad-free episodes. I host twice monthly patron-only Zoom calls where you can ask me questions, share your own thoughts, and connect with others. We also have a lively and active private Discord server where members host book clubs, happy hours, and just share their thoughts on all things anomalous without all the drama that's all too common on social media. It's a warm, open-minded, and vibrant community, and we'd love to have you join us. Memberships start at just $5 a month. You can sign up at patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole. That's patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole.
We're talking to Barbara Hand Clow, her latest book, A Revised Version of Alchemy of Nine Dimensions. If you have never read it, it is well worth your time. It's quite a book to explore. And if you have read it in the past, it's also worth picking up this version of it because there's new material here. Now, Barbara, my immediate reaction to something like the Transylvanian Sunrise is that nonsense. There are no tunnels. It's all completely in this man's head. He's gone around the bend. Mm-hmm. Why should we believe it?
Okay, good question. When people start to awaken, one of the things that they're the most curious about is all of the issues of the time machine issues, like how many of us have done past life regressions and studied books on Lemuria, Atlantis, you name it. And what people want to know at this point, and this is a very hot issue out there because of how the younger generation is waking up so quickly, they want to know the truth. Like, if it's true that civilizations were once more advanced, and if it's true that cataclysms occurred, that's a very, very big issue. And as you know,
that's
the subject of catastrophobia. I wrote a book called Catastrophobia, which is now called Awakening the Planetary Mind. I mixed up titles there a while ago. The book that I wrote on Kundalini Rising is called Astrology and the Rising of Kundalini. Excuse me. The publisher keeps putting the books back in and then changing the title on them, and then I forget what's going on after a while.
I understand.
Catastrophobia became Awakening the Planetary Mind. And the thesis of Awakening the Planetary Mind is that we are a multi-traumatized species.
Yes.
We are a species that was once very advanced, and I think these tunnels going back 50,000 years are probably one of the best examples on the planet of our previous advancement. We know most of us are very comfortable with the idea that Atlantis was once an advanced civilization, but some sort of cataclysm occurred around 12,000 years ago, and Atlantis sunk into the sea. Well, I also am an astrologer, and I also work with the issue of the great ages and the precession of the equinoxes. And where we are right now is we are at the opposite point to the sinking of Atlantis. And so we are at a very, very rapidly advancing evolution of humanity, because people are starting to remember who they were in the past. They're starting to remember what they're capable of and how we could live on this planet. And this is what the global elite is trying to make sure doesn't occur. So right now, it's a fascinating moment in time. By the way, the next 4 months will probably be the most fascinating months that either you or I will remember, because November 20th, Pluto goes into Aquarius out of Capricorn, and Pluto in Aquarius is going to be the true advanced awakening of the age of Aquarius. Then
that's also when my new book comes out.
Yeah.
It's called The Fourth Mind, and it is about everything you're talking about right now.
Yeah. And then as we go into 2025, and by the way, I want to start this little comment by saying, I don't want anybody to hear me and think everything's going to be wonderful and easy. I think the next 4 months are going to be the foremost stressful and difficult months we've ever experienced in our lives. And judging by how the last couple of months have been, especially since May, when the solar flares really intensified, this is not going to be easy, but nothing is going to stop it. And see, this is what the control forces have been afraid of. Because from the Eastern point of view, the Kali Yuga ends at the end of March 2025. And also in March 2025, we have two major, major transits, Saturn going into Aries and Neptune going into Aries. And the acceleration of these energies is just incomprehensible. I'm just doing my best with it, because boy, it's difficult for me.
Yeah, of course. Mm-hmm. Of course it is. I'm sort of boggled here, really. This is very extraordinary stuff. The reason is that it's what I'm writing now is intimately connected with everything you're saying. And the end of the Kali Yuga, can you expand a little bit more on that?
Yeah, and as you know, that's not my expertise, but I can recommend finally a new young Indian philosopher, name, let's see if I get his name right. His name is Bibu Dev something. It doesn't matter.
Send me the name and I can put it up on the splash page on the show. So,
well, the title of the book is The Yuga Shift.
And the Yuga Shift?
The Yuga Shift. That's all anybody really, really needs.
Yeah.
And what he has done, and I've been studying the yuga issue my whole life, and I've read all of the early Indian sources and everything, and they're all wonderful. But what he has done is he has really managed to relate how the yuga shift and the end of the Kali Yuga is going to affect us at this point in time.
And well, that's very important stuff. You know what happened in the West? We are notorious colonizers, the way, I mean, you know all that all too well from your own background.
Yeah.
The West is colonizing the past as well, with its own version, like the incredibly crazy idea that the great monoliths at Baalbek were moved from the quarry to their present position by the Romans.
Yeah,
it's right. A lie. It's not just a mistake. It's a lie built on arrogance. What you're looking at when you see that 1,000-ton monoliths, and the quarry is right there. You can see that from the quarry. You can see the structure. It's not far. But what is missing is any sign of any kind of a causeway beyond just a path between the two places. And why that's important is you do not move 1,000-ton monolith on wooden rollers. It's just so absurd because, if they were made of basalt, they would be there.
Mm-hmm.
If they were made of wood, they couldn't have been used. But more importantly, there is no foundation for this. No foundation. Therefore, that's not how it was done.
That's right.
They were not moved by being dragged along by Romans. They were not cut by Romans. The Romans didn't have the kind of saws that you needed. High speed saws, you didn't have them. You couldn't do it. And it's just one of many such things that are scattered around this world, the remains of a great civilization that was here. And that word, catastrophobia, they should not have changed the title, because that defines reality. We are living in amnesia. Mankind is a species in amnesia.
Mm-hmm.
We have not forgotten our past. We have hidden it from ourselves because we once had powers that we have lost.
Yeah, but they're coming back. And I'm
and
so
they glad. Are coming back. That's
and I'm so glad you brought
you're
up
working about on and where I'm working on and a lot of people.
Yeah, and so I'm so glad you brought up Baalbek, because that's one of the best examples that I know of on the planet of the people, what people were doing 50,000 years ago. See, that's how far back this goes. And some of the deepest, the way you can recognize that technology, because I've run around and tried to find it. I mean, it's all over the planet. The further down you go at some of these really incredible archaeological sites like Baalbek, the stones get bigger and more complex, and the accuracy of the stone settings is much more advanced. Peru being a very good example, like Sacsayhuaman. And so you can literally see three of the great precessional ages in places where there's three levels of the stone technology.
Or
so they don't want you to know that.
It's amazing. I mean, we think of, well, it ended obviously 12,000 years ago in a catastrophe, which I know a lot about. And we're not going to go there today because that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about was when it was in its glory, and it thrived for thousands of years.
That's right.
And then suddenly was destroyed.
That's right. So just think, when it was destroyed during the cataclysm, 12,000 years ago, the beginning of this Yuga cycle that we're in now, that was a monument at that point that would have been at that point around 40,000 years old.
Yeah, exactly.
And then
it's important to understand that when we see these things, we're looking at the remains of something very old.
Oh, yeah.
It was already old in 12,000 years ago. Exactly. And what it was used for, nobody knows. Nobody understands anymore what the pyramid is. We have implications and I've said this many times, and if you can go out of your body, try going to the Great Pyramid. Don't force yourself out of your body. Don't hurt yourself. Use like Robert Monroe's techniques or any other techniques. And if you do get out, go to the Great Pyramid. See what happens. I'm not going to tell you. I'm only going to say it still works.
Yes, I know. And I've taught in the King's Chamber and the Great Pyramid and in temples in Egypt many, many times. And there's absolutely no question. The minute you get, within 50 miles of the Nile, and then you start moving closer to Cairo and closer to the ancient sites, there's a distinctive change right in the atmosphere, right in you can feel it in your body. And this technology is still functioning. And in yes. many, many sacred, I say the same thing about many sacred sites.
Many are many. Still very much alive. You just have to know what to do. Free listeners, we've reached the end of your part of the show. I love you, and I want you to subscribe to this website. We're talking to Barbara Hand Clow, an amazing human being, alchemy of nine dimensions, activating the full spectrum of consciousness. Do you want to give it a shot? See if you can actually step out of your bubble? Get the book and get engaged with this. Do this now. This is important stuff. We'll see you again next week.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.